Windhagen. I'm a professor of resistance studies and sociology here at UMass and directing the resistance studies initiative. We have during this fall an impressive list of speakers, and I will soon introduce Professor Amilcar Shabazz, but I want to mention that next time we have November 1st, Logbona Olukone, that is talking about resistance is a bridge between activists, blackness, and queerness in Cuba and Chiapas. And on Monday, December the 4th, we have John Higginson speaking about why revolutions. The Resistance Studies Initiative has been going on here at UMass since 2014, and one of the things we're doing is that we are putting out the first journal in the world on resistance studies, and you have free copies here you can take if you're interested. Please spread to others, and particularly to the libraries, to get them to make subscriptions, then we might survive longer. Welcome. Right. So we also have a listserv where we send out a lot of information about resistance studies, relevant stuff that is going on both inside this campus and outside. So if you want to be on that list, please sign the mailing list signing sheets that are circulating around here. We have two of them circulating. So right up here, in case you want that information. Yeah, then we are very happy to have Professor Amilcar Shabazz here with us today. That's been working very much on issues around black liberation, and we have been had the possibility to collaborate with one event that happened here at UMass around intergenerational dialogue between black liberation leaders from the 60s and also with Black Lives Matters today. So, thank you so much for agreeing to come here, and the floor is yours, and we will save time also for questions and discussions towards the end. Some of my students will also drop in here around 4. The problem is that the class was scheduled before normally, and some of them were not able to come earlier. So if people are coming in late, you know why, right? Great.
Good.
Thank you. So,
Assata Shakur as the soul of black resistance. It is, I'd like to give some thanks. First of all, thanks to the Resistance Studies Initiative, Stellan, Debbie, everyone involved. This opportunity to present in this fall speaker series is something I very much appreciate. Has given me an opportunity to focus on an issue that I've been working on through the years, and really give me a chance to focus my attention on it. And I look forward to your feedback today. I also would like to give thanks to an organization some of you may know nothing about that I knew and became aware of in the 1980s, soon after they were founded, called the John Brown Anti-Klan Committee. And what you are seeing here is one of their papers. They published a paper, and the masthead is "No KKK, No Fascist USA." It's also a slogan at a lot of their rallies and demonstrations. Through the John Brown Anti-Klan Committee, particularly some of its members in the Austin, Texas area, where I was an undergraduate student, they enabled me, particularly organizers such as Linda Evans, and Betty Ann Duke. I was able to meet the gentleman you see in the picture here, Ahmed Obafemi. Ahmed Obafemi had himself been a political prisoner, but at the time that I met him, he was brought into the Austin area, and my organization that I was a part of, called the Southern African Liberation Action Committee, co-sponsored his visit to talk about a recent trip that he had been on to Zimbabwe. In fact, it was Zimbabwe as it was making its transition from the former settler colony of Rhodesia into Zimbabwe, and he was there on as part of a delegation of activists from the United States to learn from and to connect with the activists who were making that change from the settler colony of Rhodesia to Zimbabwe. People such as Robert Mugabe, Turai Ropa, many others, they were able to meet them in that pivotal moment moving toward the liberation of Zimbabwe. And they came back to report on it. And my organization, which had been supporting liberation throughout the African continent, particularly with a focus on Southern Africa, we were happy to host him and to hear from him with that kind of live firsthand report about the changes there. But after the talk was all over and I had a chance to talk to him a little more, I recognized that he was not simply a solidarity activist with struggles on the African continent, but he was an activist and had been a longtime activist in the struggle here in the United States. And he was at that time the Eastern Regional Vice President of the Provisional Government of the Republic of New Africa. And it was in that connection then that we began to develop a relationship that led me to join him to come up there in 1981 and then on a long-term basis in 1982 to be part of an organization he had established called the National Committee to Defend New African Freedom Fighters. In 81, it was actually National Committee to Honor New African Freedom Fighters, and then it became the National Committee to Defend New African Freedom Fighters. And it was in that context when I moved up there in January of 82 that I met this woman here, Yuri Kochiyama. Yuri Kochiyama was a member of the National Committee to Defend New African Freedom Fighters. This picture here is taken in her home, and her home was wall-to-wall posters, revolutionary posters from all over the world. And this woman I learned so much from and grew to love her so much. One of her things is that she would write political dissidents. She would write political activists who were incarcerated, prisoners of war, political prisoners from all kinds of struggles all over the world, and write them regularly, write them keeping them abreast of what was going on. She was very much involved in a deep human way with political exiles, political prisoners. And so I learned so much from her. And she was directly a part of this effort to the National Committee to Defend New African Freedom Fighters. So I thank both of them, because it was through them that I really came to learn about the issue of political prisoners, prisoners of war, dissidents in the United States in a way I could not have imagined back in Austin, Texas. And indeed, actually through them, I ultimately came to directly know about Sister Assata Shakur and came to see her as this and know of her role as this symbol of as the soul of Black resistance. So let me outline a few of my critical reflections I want to offer today. First of all, I want to interrogate this discourse of Black liberation, and to do so, we have to first, and students of mine that are here know I always like to start from the title. And so even within my own title, what are these words soul, and what are this word resistance? So I'll offer a few opening thoughts on those terms just to get a connection with you on how I'm using these terms. Then I want to go into Assata Shakur and the discourse of Black liberation and look at her in terms of spirituality, in terms of this ethic of love that she embodies, as well as her as this symbol of people's struggle and people's power. And finally, very briefly, just to talk a little bit about implications for policy research and analysis, particularly in relation to lessons of COINTELPRO, and I'll give a thumbnail to that, thumbnail sketch of that, because it directly relates to the whole political situation of Assata Shakur, but then also countering current attacks on the Black Liberation Movement. So soul. Soul is typically defined, basically defined, as the spiritual or immaterial part of a living thing. It's regarded as indestructible. It's regarded as immortal. Okay, it's the part that even if you destroy this physical body right here, this soul that inhabits me continues. This soul that inhabits this body continues in some way, shape, or form. It may continue in memory, people's memory of me, and how they speak of me after this transition from this physical body. It may be in other ways, but this is one way in which we speak of a soul. It's also the essence or the embodiment of a specific quality. In this case, the quality of resistance. We want to talk when we speak of the soul of a resistance movement, then we're talking about the essence and someone that embodied that resistance. One can also speak of soul from an African-centered point of view as voodoo, as in other different words from other languages, but as spiritual force or energy. And in all of these definitions, we can certainly begin to apply them and use them to interrogate the discourse of Black liberation in connection with Sister Assata Shakur. And as the quote here from bell hooks refers, it is crucial for the future of the Black liberation struggle that we remain ever mindful that ours is a shared struggle, that we are each other's fate. And I think that point of view is something that is very much the way Sister Assata approaches things. The question of resistance. For the concept of resistance, I particularly want to put Assata Shakur in dialogue with the work of Stellan Vinthagen, particularly his theory of nonviolent action. And that might seem problematic to you. How on a theory, from a theory of nonviolent action, do I intend to place in connection with that a woman who has, without playing the videotape, 45, you know, thunders, is a cop killer, is this a full embodiment of violence and of terrorism. How can I put them in connection? Well, I hope we can begin to see it. But first of all, I want to take off from, I have two sources for my defining the concept of resistance. And one is from Stellan Vinthagen's theory of nonviolent action. He refers to how our capacity for resistance depends in a profound sense on whether or not power has the ability to shape people. If power is able to shape our ways of thinking, behaving, and acting, resistance becomes much harder, as that power is incorporated within us as individuals and in our culture. So in this sense, resistance is power breaking. It's breaking the chains, to borrow from a poem by Sister Assata Shakur. It's breaking the chains of established power, of the power holders over how we think, how we behave, and how we act in the world. The other quote is here, some of you may recognize it. Who's it from? The bottom quote. Each generation must, out of relative obscurity, discover its mission, fulfill it, or betray it. In underdeveloped countries, the preceding generations have both resisted the work or erosion carried by colonialism and also helped on the maturing of the struggles of today. This is from Frantz Fanon. And what I'm getting at, and want to borrow from Fanon is this idea of resistance as an ongoing, perpetual kind of activity and quality, but specifically to borrow from it as part of the decolonizing project. Because in this sense, I speak of Assata as the soul. We can look at and interrogate Assata as the soul of Black resistance, as a project of decolonization, of ending the control of one nation or of one group or of one set of power holders over over a collective people. So let us then begin to look at these qualities of Assata. Assata, I first said I would want to talk about things from a spiritual sense. And in this regard, one of the things I would point to is a film by a filmmaker we had here recently, Gloria Rolando. We had her here last spring? And in that film entitled The Eyes of the Rainbow, she deals with the life of Assata Shakur. In English, it's only 47 minutes long. I highly recommend your viewing it. But within it, you see her take on the meaning of Assata. Assata enters a certain discourse with Assata in connection with representations of the Yoruba warrior Orishas, such as Oya and Ochosi. And those are then woven into the discourse of the film to illustrate how Assata becomes a mother in prison, how Assata becomes this figure of Black resistance. And also, besides the Yoruba, a warrior Orishas of Oya and Ochosi, she also interweaves it with an understanding of the tenderness as seen, as represented in the dance of Oshun. And so with all of this, we begin to see one representation. One can look at this as one representation of Assata as this spiritual figure. There are certainly many other ways as well, but continuing with her as, beyond the, from the spiritual dimension, this question of the love ethic. And in the founding of the Black Liberation Army and in her decisions, which the main source you can look at for her own words and reflections on this is her autobiography, Assata. And as such then, she makes it very clear that it is not about some sort of extreme attachment to Black identity or some sort of Black racism that she is operating from, but from an ethic of an undying love for her people. She writes, "Nobody in the world, nobody in history, has ever gotten their freedom by appealing to the moral sense of the people who were oppressing them. Once you study and really get a good understanding of the way the system in the United States work, then you see, without a doubt, that the civil rights movement never had a chance of succeeding. White people, whether they are from the North or from the South, whether it is in 1960 or 1980, benefit from the oppression of Black people. Those who believe that the president or the vice president and the Congress and the Supreme Court run this country are sadly mistaken. The almighty dollar is king. Those who have the most money control the country and through campaign contributions buy and sell presidents and now actually become them. Congressmen, they buy and sell congressmen and judges, the one who pass the laws and enforce the laws that benefit their benefactors. The rich have always used racism to maintain power, to hate someone, to discriminate against them, and to attack them because of their racial characteristics is one of the most primitive, reactionary, ignorant ways of thinking that exists. A war between the races would help nobody and free nobody and should be avoided at all costs. But a one-sided race war with black people as the targets and white people shooting the guns is worse. We will be criminally negligent, however, if we do not deal with racism and racist violence and if we do not prepare to defend ourselves against it. That's her, in her own words, describing her analysis and her feeling to become the warrior she became. She wasn't born that, and you can read her story, and it goes very much into her origins and her coming up. So wasn't born a warrior, she became a warrior. Finally, let's can say more about the love ethic, and I'll get into it a little bit later, but let me keep this moving and talk about her as a symbol. Here we see a rather iconic film of her in leg irons and manacled at the wrist and around the waist. It's I was first to see this when I moved from Austin, Texas to New York with the National Committee to Defend You African Freedom Fighters, when they would bring in court the defendants and former comrades of Assata's, such as Sekou Odinga, Kwesi Balogun, Jamal Joseph. When they would bring these folks in court, this is how they would bring them out into public and into the court. I want to reference here at this moment and looking at her in symbolic terms, an album by the Midnight Band entitled The First Minute of a New Day. This was by Gil Scott-Heron and Brian Jackson, and I want you to look at the imagery of the album art. So first of all, here on this cover, what do we see? Anyone? A gorilla sitting in a chair. Who can add by specifically what does that chair, what maybe is that chair reminiscent of? But of a particular figure not long around that same time has an iconic picture in such a chair. Who? Got a West Coaster here. Huey Newton, very iconic picture of him sitting in a wicker chair like this. Now, so we replace Newton in that chair now with a gorilla. And then we see the hands of a clock, and it's about what time? Either, huh? Yes. So it's a quarter of midnight or it's a quarter of noon, but by the title of the album, we know it's a quarter of midnight. So it's very close to being the first minute of a new day. Here we see the back. And what do we see now? With the what? With the clock. The clock is what time? It's a little bit after 12. So now the gorilla that was sitting in the chair in that 15 minutes that passed for you, of you turning the cover over, now we see it's a minute after, a minute, we're in that first minute of a new day. So we're at midnight, and we see we now have the gorilla has geared up in uniform with an automatic rifle and is moving through the streets to defend, to protect the people in the ghetto, the people in the urban environment. One of the performers on that album was Bilal Sunni Ali. This is also a detail from the inside of the album. And Bilal Sunni Ali, I would come to meet in New York as well. He was on trial when I moved there for being a part of a conspiracy, according to the government, that included the liberation of Assata Shakur from prison in 1979, that included bank expropriation, that included this whole pattern of criminal activity, and he was charged with that. He was represented in court by an attorney by the name of Shokwe Lumumba, and he gets off completely. That the jury did not convict Bilal Suni Ali in that trial. At the same time, so I mentioned this liberation by a force that we can liken to the guerrilla in that album. A unit of the Black Liberation Army would take credit for going into a prison in 1979 and liberating Assata Shakur. They did this 3 days before a major event happened in New York that had been planned, of folks marching to the United Nations in raising the question of the oppression of African Americans and the oppression in the world, and 5,000 people will march, and the news of her liberation is broken in a communique, a Black Liberation Army communique, at that march with all those thousands that go. And soon after that, then, these posters will begin to spring up. This particularly by the Republic of New Africa that would go out far and wide. Assata Shakur is welcome here. Because at that moment, then, she has escaped. She is underground. She is fugitive. Holders are furiously enacting their forces to find her, to catch her. Particularly in New York City, raids are happening on people's apartments, people's private, people who have a fro, women who have a fro, and they think that it's Assata. It's really chaotic in those days and months after her liberation in November of 1979. But as this goes along, but this then is then part of this symbolic representation of Assata as that her liberation, her or escape, if you wish, from prison is then not the breaking out of a criminal by criminals, but rather is the liberation of a part of the community, a part of the people who was unjustly incarcerated and who continues to fight for the people. So it is our victory, if you will. By 1981, then, we continue to see this, and again, she is still somewhere in the whirlwind. She is somewhere in the world. And we see a demonstration being held to honor her and other New African freedom fighters, and it is being held on her birthday, July 18, 1981. And I travel up from Austin, Texas, for that event at the Harlem State Office Building, now known as the Adam Clayton Powell State Office Building, on the corner of 125th or near 125th and Malcolm X Boulevard. And we see then the imagery here on this flyer, that this is a very iconic image of the African freedom fighter. The woman in, whether in Guinea-Bissau under the leadership of Amilcar Cabral, or in Angola, or in Mozambique, these were images of people who took up the gun to liberate themselves from colonialism, colonial oppression. And so we see those kinds of images being placed here with masses with arms, with Assata's picture then in the middle of the five-state territory declared by the Republic of New Africa as the national territory of colonized African people in the U.S. And so directly to honor the Black Liberation Army, and this is going out far and wide. I'd like to mention as well, as we move along here in 81, a memorial service for a black freedom fighter, Imtiyari Shabaka Sundiata, who was shot and killed as he was by police officers on October 23rd, 1981. Imtiyari was an activist, was with Brother Sekou Odinga and others identified as part of the Black Liberation Army. And when he and Sekou are captured, Sekou is taken in live, but in the case of Imtiyari, the officer will move his bulletproof vest that he was wearing and fire point blank, killing him, point blank at his heart, killing him. At the memorial service, we see here the that was held in Brooklyn, a poem that Imtiyari Shabaka Sundiata wrote back in 73 for Assata, entitled "By Choice, You Are Assata." And I would just hinge on, in connection with my argument, hinge on this particular part of it. By choice, you are a symbol of truth. Your every body movement says to the black man blinded by the brutality of the white whore that has kept him prostrated before the vagina of a dying society, raise your eyes from the filth of the American dream and watch my body movement. Watch me more move to the beat of a different drummer. By choice, Assata, you turned us into a brave and proud army. Now we move with the same rhythm that moves you against the American dream. We too are dedicated to the death of the monster called oppression. By choice, we now turn to face the nation of our survival, and the synthetic melodies of the American dream fades in the background as we move with the celestial beat of Sun Ra to outer space, outer their space of oppression into our space of being. Us African people. Moving on to 84, we see New African Freedom Fighter Day continuing. We see here, and at this point, the New African People's Organization has been founded along with what is, though it's referenced here as the National Committee to Defend New African Freedom Fighters. And we see the figure of a black man with Black Power salute being imprisoned by the bars of the American flag. Moving up to 1985, on the Black Nation Day, which is always in March of every year, we see here the linkage once again of Assata Shakur right in the middle of things with Malcolm X, with Sister Dara Abubakari, who is president of the Republic of New Odinga right here, with Chokwe Lumumba, the attorney and activist right here, Robert Williams, the first president of the Republic of New Africa, a drummer, members of the New African Scouts, a youth formation, as well as pictures of different folks in demonstration and in revolt. And at this, we see concert is held, workshops are held, self-determination forum, a spiritual rally, and speakers there included Mario Badelli, Dara Abubakari. And in fact, it's an important event that was held here because it's part of a reunification, because Sister Dara Abubakari and Chokwe Lumumba and Ahmed Obafemi, Fulani Suni Ali were kind of in one group of RNA activists that had become estranged from Imari Obadeli and many that he was part of. And here we now have a reunification of these different forces. Also, representatives from different African liberation movements, Puerto Rican liberation movements, and others were all present. And here we see the ubiquitous slogan, Free the Land. Moving a little quickly, linkage of South Africa to New Africa. Buttons that were produced back then, Assata Shakur identifying her as a freedom fighter. Here we have a Black Solidarity Day salute. Remember again, it's at that Black Solidarity Day event in 79 that her liberation from prison was timed by the BLA. But by this point, her longtime comrade, Mutulu Shakur, is now in prison. And so the focus is not only on her and commemorating her liberation, but also pointing out the need for the community to unite to free Mutulu Shakur. An exclusive at this event was a video of Assata speaking from Cuba. It had only been a couple of years before then that it was publicly announced that Cuba was providing asylum, political asylum for Assata. And I want to note here, Sonia Sanchez, as one of the special guest speakers, had long been a supporter. And in fact, this I could go into much greater detail on this idea of Assata as this spiritual figure besides the film by Gloria Rolando. The writings of Sonia Sanchez points to her in the same way, speaks of her as this prophetess, as this priestess of our struggle. Sonia is and would speak to it at this event as well, the spiritual prophetic character of Assata. She has been very much a part. There's a book of poetry that Sonia will edit and co-edit with Bibi Angola that brings together all this poetry by major poets on Assata, as well as some of Assata's own poetry, that where this idea of her as this spiritual figure also emerges. Turning now to further into the 80s, we have in 1987 the release of one of the first kind of hip-hop interventions or representations of Assata as this symbol, as this soul of Black resistance in the song Rebel Without a Pause. And for time, I'm just going to keep it moving and not some of you old, if there are any old hip-hop heads here. By the way, is anybody here 70 or older? Have anybody 70 or older? Okay, so I'm probably the elder, so hence I didn't ask for permission to speak, so... I'm probably the elder in the room.
He looks younger than what he
is. But Assata Shakur is 70 years old, by the way. She turned 70 this past July. But here we see one of the first representations in hip-hop there in 1987. And so just to radio suckers, never play me in the voice of Chuck D, a little deeper than mine. And Chuck D and I are the same age. Exactly the same age. We first ran into each other on the streets of Harlem. He was going around, he and some of his crew were going around tagging the subway walls, tagging buildings with this image of the young Black youth. Sorry about that. The young Black youth in the crosshairs of the sniper scope. And what's the stance the youth is in? Anybody know the language? What's it called? B-boy is another B word for it. The buffalo stance. Never heard that one, did you? It's called the buffalo stance. Buffalo soldier, courage, buffalo. B-boy, buffalo stance. And they were tagging that while I was putting up one of those posters you saw for the New African Freedom Fighters Day. And we said, ooh, what are you doing? And so maybe I even, maybe we even turned him on to Assata Shakur from that night, because then he comes out with this song. Radio suckers never play me on the mix, they just okay me. Now known and grown, when they're clocking my zone, it's known. Snaking and taking everything that a brother owns. Hard, my calling card. Recorded and ordered, supporter of Chesimard. Loud and proud, kicking live, next poet supreme. Looper, troop, bazooka, the scheme. Flavor, a rebel in his own mind, supporter of my rhyme. Designed to scatter a line of suckers who claim I do crime. They on my time ticket. So Chesimard is the married name of Assata Shakur. She was born Joanne Deborah Byron, is married to a Chesimard, became Joanne Chesimard, and that's how she's known in all the FBI wanted posters and officially and through court was through the name Joanne Chesimard. So he's referencing there, I'm a supporter of Chesimard, that then verifies, if you will, that he's hard, that hard is his calling card. Talked about the autobiography a little bit, but that comes out in the 80s as well. That is her first full-blown statement. But again, there had been many other statements. There was a pamphlet that came out from her from somewhere in the world that was also a cassette tape. Used to play the cassette tape over and over again. Go to bed listening to the cassette tape, and it has a song that I'll play in just a moment that prefaces it. She prefaces it, her statement, with a song, I Do Love You. I Do Love You. And we'll listen to that. But Hands Off Assata campaign comes up when efforts are made to suddenly announce all these desire to get Cuba to, it's now known she's in Cuba, and to get Cuba to extradite her, to return her, even though there's no articles, laws of extradition that U.S. and Cuba honor with each other. But so a campaign begins from members of the hip hop movement that argues that and with things such as earrings, Hands Off Assata, buttons, Hands Off Assata, trying to galvanize the support of young people, of people all over, for the campaign to try to stop these efforts of the U.S. government to pressure Cuba to return her. Assata today, you tomorrow. You begin to see the linkage here again in some of the literature. The first need of a free people is to define their own terms. And then here as well, a picture of Stokely Carmichael in there doing some of his teaching. This campaign of Hands Off Assata was particularly led by an African-American woman. Got maybe some little help out of it from Jay-Z as he was coming up. And some say Jay-Z and his wife Beyonce, when they made their celebrated trip to Cuba, attempted to see Sister Assata there. But we'll leave that for the state to figure out. Here we see Hands Off Assata in t-shirts. Again, the red, black, and green flag of Black liberation is there as well. There are murals all over the place that link Assata with Harriet Tubman, link her within the long tradition of African-American freedom struggle. I'll end in a moment with a picture closer to home of a wonderful mural that features a quote by Sister Assata. Of course, during this time, the FBI has raised the bounty for her capture from 1 million to 2 million. We're moving now closer up to the present. This is under Barack Obama. It's increased from 1 million to 2 million. Also under Barack Obama, she is, for the first time, it's no longer a reference to her as this criminal, as this bank robber cop killer, but it's now a particular reference to her as this terrorist. She is actually the first woman to be placed by the United States on the list of terrorists that the FBI is after. So now we've moved it to a whole other area. This is a billboard in New Jersey, in the state where the crime that she was convicted of after many attempts, and 4 years after her capture. She's captured in 73. It's not until 1977 that she is actually convicted of anything. They go through trial after trial, and in 77 she is convicted for the death of this New Jersey state trooper. The billboards then in New Jersey, and New Jersey has become this kind of, you know, real locus for get Chesham art. So we've mentioned Rebel Without a Pause. Within hip hop, the hip hop discourse, many other artists are going to after Chuck D and Public Enemy in 87. Many others. There will be Paris, Digable Planets, X-Clan, Common most notably has a love song for Assata Shakur that he comes out with and is very popular with. At the same time, he's invited to the White House, and it creates a bit of a discord, because here's Barack Obama inviting a man to the White House that has a song praising the person he's just raised the bounty to $2 million and has labeled her this international terrorist. Most Def, Tuya Autry, Walida, Imarisha. These are just some of them. And there's a very good piece by a communications professor named Lisa Corrigan analyzing the hip hop discourse, some of these, some of the works of different hip hop artists in relation to Assata's work as a figure of black resistance. And so I just summarized some of this within hip hop with the words of Davy D. Of course she was a rebel. Davy says she's been a rebel, not in some sort of nostalgic way, but in a real way that people can relate to. He says, his supporter, we don't see her as some crazed cop killer, the way the popular narrative would have you believe. She was somebody who was about defending our community. She comes on the scene as a response to our community being attacked by racist forces. So there's the hip hop discourse just directly stating how they see her, how they're relating to her. There's also this womanist dynamic that we would want to look at in terms of black women's discourse around Assata as a figure. Here, and we can certainly see this in the establishment of the Black Lives Matter movement, most notably by three African women of African descent, and particularly how in that movement words of Assata are used as a very call to unity. Of course, the words being, and there's a certain way it is done where part of the words are called out. There's a call and response dynamic. So it is our duty to fight for freedom, and then response from the, it is our duty to fight, it is our duty to win. And it's done first in a very soft voice, and then it goes to a natural voice, and then it ends in a clarion call voice. So it's a very specific thing, and again, it's Assata's words being used and being as this galvanizing words within Black Lives Matter movement. On the opposition, this has really gone viral with the alt-right, with the white nationalists, white supremacists, and just taken the other day, this is was the logo from the early 70s of the Black Liberation Army, with pictures of five key people to the Black Liberation Army. Assata at the very top, the soul of the BLA, the soul of the army. But then Matulu Shakur flanking Sundiata Okoli, whom she was arrested with when she was arrested in New Jersey in 73. Sekou Odinga, who served decades behind bars and is now free. We had him out here this past spring. Hope to bring him out again to discuss more of his life and struggle. and Jaleel Muntakeen, a New York Panther who goes underground as well and becomes part of the black. They note she is how Assata and this is inspiration for Black Lives Matter. Is FBI's most wanted, Assata Shakur, a convicted cop killer, is BLM's ideal guru and former BLA boss. So we begin to see this is the contending narrative. This is the contending narrative. And of course, one that has been given credence was given voice by the 45th president when he announced the so-called ending of Obama's policies toward Cuba and his pushing this reset button. He goes to Florida and he's begins to broadcast this contending idea about Assata. Here's the, by the way, just a little bit of the song that had come out in 79. And in the cassette tape of her communique, this is before she's announced in Cuba, we would get the recording of her and we mass produced the cassette tape. And this was her choice to preface before she comes in speaking. A very popular song at the time, but one that she saw she desired to have present her herself to people through, to hear her in her own voice, but prefaced by this in this song of love, I love you. But then to conclude and give some time for some discussion here, I just would bring this a little bit up to right now. I mentioned COINTELPRO. COINTELPRO is an acronym that stands for Counterintelligence Program. It describes a broad set of repressive activities by the U.S. government, particularly by the Federal Bureau of Investigation, that began and came to full form under the FBI headed by J. Edgar Hoover. And these activities were directed against many movements and many individuals, but most notably the civil rights movement and on into what is referred to in historical literature as the Black Power movement. But COINTELPRO was directed against Malcolm X, was directed against Martin Luther King, was directed against all of these historical figures from the 60s, accelerates with this memorandum that from Hoover out to all field agents of the FBI, calling for specific actions to disrupt, to discredit, and to neutralize black militants from having any credibility in the community, and that action should be taken along those lines to prevent, as it were, the rise of a black messiah. To prevent the rise of a black messiah. Okay, that's the language of the field directive throughout the FBI. Now, in the 70s, through in the U.S. Congress, Frank Church, who opened certain probes into FBI activities. Against anti-war movement, against all kinds of movements. We particularly learned a lot about the COINTELPRO no one ever knew of things going on. So a lot of the dissension within the Black Panther Party, for example, that leads to its demise was fomented under COINTELPRO. A lot of the things that were alleged to have been activities showing the criminal nature of radical Black movements or individuals turns out to have been things set up by agent provocateurs that the movement was explicitly rejecting, but then somehow is now becomes part of the narrative of the movement. So much was revealed through the Senate inquiry, the congressional inquiries into FBI on this thing of COINTELPRO that we've learned quite a bit, but there are many lessons we still need to learn from it. And we need to look at this particularly in light of what has come out from the FBI, some new directive this past August that has created this new category of Black identity extremism. And just to give a quick thumbnail to it, play this.
An FBI report from August has recently been discovered identifying Black identity extremists as a terrorist threat. Now, I read through this report, and it reads that the FBI assesses it is very likely Black identity extremist, or BIE, perceptions of police brutality against African Americans spurred an increase in premeditated retaliatory lethal violence against law enforcement and will very likely serve as justification for such violence. The FBI assess it is very likely this increase began following the August 9th, 2014 shooting of Michael Brown in Ferguson, Missouri, and the FBI assesses it is very likely incidents of alleged police abuse against African Americans since then have continued to feed the resurgence and ideologically motivated violent criminal activity within the BIE movement. So I want to read you more from this report, but I do want you to pay attention to some of the terminology that they're using here. And I tried to really emphasize it when I was speaking, but they say perceptions of police brutality, alleged police abuse, because apparently, according to the FBI, it's not that these people who are committing these acts of violence are mad about the racism, they're apparently being irrational in their reactions to the racism, according to the FBI.
And before you go on, Hannah, yeah. I just want to know for the record, there is no such thing as Black identity extremists.
No.
Well, there is now because it's in a piece of paper.
Mm.
Like they wrote it down. I mean, that's how that's the sad truth, is now they've created a category they can funnel people into.
Well, basically what they're doing is they're trying to relabel, you know, the BLM as something that it's not. That's what they're trying to do. I mean, it's pretty obvious as you read throughout here that it's all about like Black Lives Matter movement, but they just sort of like rephrased it so that they're not as explicit with how racist they're being. Now they cite violence against police officers as a reason for this identification. They go into the FBI judges very likely BIE perceptions of police brutality against African Americans have become organizing drivers for the BIE movement since 2014. I think that's another sort of very clearly alluding to the BLM movement, resulting in a spike of BIEs intentionally targeting law enforcement with violence. And they say even though these five of these attacks occurred following controversial police shootings of African Americans by white police officers, the BIE or targeting of officers was not in every incident based on specific race. Now they go into in great detail all of the violence against police officers, yet they don't do any sort of detail about violence against Black people. And they just continue and go into this. And the FBI has a pretty thorough record of being pretty racist. And when you look at the counterintelligence program that they used to carry out and still continue to carry out, they've always sort of like, they targeted the Black Panthers, they targeted Martin Luther King, they targeted people during the Civil Rights Movement. This is not a new game for them.
So stop it there. I've downloaded the document and have begun to read it and can offer some comments on it myself, going beyond what's presented right there. But in essence, the Young Turks here are making some good commentary, some good points about it, but we can go even further. But I want to give the BLM, if you will, their chance to make their own counterpoint.
Black identity extremism. and justify increased police presence in black communities. If you look up black identity extremism, you won't find it online anywhere, because prior to a recent FBI report, it didn't exist. The report that introduced the term was released August 3rd, only a few days before the deadly white supremacist rally that took place in Charlottesville, Virginia. In the report, the FBI creates a narrative of a dangerous racially motivated group, whose perceptions of police brutality against black people have spurred increased violence against law enforcement. Right-wing extremism leads to far more police deaths than what the report cites. And this year alone, 168 black people have been killed by terrorists. In fact, white supremacists and right-wing extremism are responsible for 73% of deadly U.S. domestic terror attacks in 2001, and have killed more than two-thirds of police officers compared to their left-wing counterparts. Despite these stats, police kill black people 2.5 times more than they kill white people, and kill unarmed black people 5 times the rate that they kill unarmed white people. So, what is this distracting us from? In 2009, the FBI's Countering Violent Extremism Unit released a report indicating that the greatest domestic threat to the U.S. was the rise of right-wing extremism, a rise that was a backlash to the first black president. When this report was released, the Republican Party took offense to the political overlap and gutted the department. Today, under the Trump administration, the Countering Violent Extremism body has been turned into Countering Islamic Extremism. And now they've created the myth of black identity extremism, all while right-wing extremism grows unchecked. Right-wing extremists are violently anti-police and anti-government and have killed more people than any other group since 2001. Today, there's a minimum of 450 known white supremacists and right-wing extremist groups in the U.S. This is far more than any other group. Despite these overwhelming numbers, the FBI can only cite 6 examples of premeditated violence against police. The examples indicate very different circumstances and ideologies, with race being the only common thread. They cite the killing of Michael Brown as a galvanizing moment, making clear that the FBI is connecting this to Black Lives Matter, a consistent subtext throughout the report. The FBI is politically motivated to find an equivalent to white supremacists, even where one doesn't exist. This is simply the latest tactic the FBI is using to justify tracking and criminalizing black activists. The most famous example being COINTELPRO in the late 1950s, designed to infiltrate and neutralize black nationalist movements. This report will be used to criminalize and surveil black activists seeking an end to police brutality. And most alarmingly, the only consistent thread that classifies black identity extremism is the premise of black identity extremism is racist. Anti-black racism and Islamophobia are being used to trick people to focusing away from the very dangerous reality of right-wing extremism and white supremacy in the U.S. The FBI has done this before. We cannot allow them to do it again.
Black is beautiful!
I want to underscore that point. The FBI has done it before. We cannot allow them to do it again. And I think that by this kind of study of Assata Shakur, by this kind of open interrogation and of identifying, if you will, with the resistance dimension that she has exhibited all her life long, that we can make sure this will not happen again. I'll stop there and hope we can have some good discussion of these matters.